This is a tax credit scholarship program for educational savings accounts. So there's kind of two parts. There's the funding side, which is the tax credit side. That's how it's funded. And then the scholarship portion is the ESA. And it's different than your traditional school choice program. It really empowers parents to revolutionize their education. It really empowers parents. It's not just for tuition. It can be used for tutoring. It can be used for curriculum, or it can be used for tuition. It is limited for kids with disabilities, active military families, active duty, and then also kids that are in the custody of the state, or state's custody. The amount of the tax credit is limited to the state adequacy target, which is around $6,200. On the tax credit side, it's 100% of the donations, but it cannot exceed the tax liability of the person that's making the donation. It can be carried forward up to 4 years, and it is non-transferable, so it cannot be sold. I believe this bill is constitutional. There is 16 states, which and I passed out a handout that has those 16 states that have tax credit scholarship programs. There, as of 2014, there was roughly around 200,000 students that were participating in these type of programs in other states. If you look at Arizona, Arizona has an ESA bill, and on the sheet that I passed out, what you'll find is that parents are very satisfied with the program. So parents want this, or once they participate, they are very excited about being part of it. You can compare that to the public schools right above there. You know, nearly 30% are very unsatisfied, and you know, of the participants that responded to the ESA program, there wasn't anybody that was unsatisfied with the program. And the vast majority were very satisfied. Also, another thing to consider is, if you just look at the bill that we just heard dealing with Braille, sometimes the public schools aren't just you know, totally meeting all the needs of all the students. So why not empower parents to see what their kids need? And you know, you may have a kid who may not be legally blind, but maybe have trouble reading, and maybe there's better options out there for them. So why not empower the parents to make that choice? And another thing to consider is, you know, many of the reason why I picked these three groups is because these three groups tend to be more difficult. Sometimes they're more mobile. I mean, if you're active military family, you might be moving around a lot and might not be in a stable environment. Same thing with foster kids. Might not be, you know, they're constantly moving around. So why not empower the decision makers or the parents to make those decisions? Also, the other argument I would make is, if public money is going to fund public education, that is public education. Public education is not an institution. It's basically putting money to educate a child, and that's no different. So I know there's other witnesses, and I know we have other bills. I'm happy to answer any questions.
My granddaughter is a special needs, and she attends a state school in the next township over. They have to centralize to accommodate as much as possible. And I understand the special needs portion of it. And I was involved a few years ago in passing the Pregnancy Resource Center tax credit, the benevolence tax credit programs. There were several of them. And I'm wondering how the foster child fits in. So as a business owner like myself, if I wanted to pay into a tax credit program similar to the Pregnancy Resource Center, and those funds could be used for those foster kids, how is that, how's that delivered to the students or used by the
students? Yeah, there's going to be a non-for-profit that receives these money, and then they would be in charge of handing out the scholarships. You know, another thing related to the foster care, and we might have to change one of our definitions on page 7 of the bill. Under qualified school, I'd like to add public school into that definition. Sometimes you may have a foster child that's adopted out, and then they are no longer allowed to go to that public school, you know, without paying tuition. And I think that doesn't make sense if the parents that adopted that child want to keep that child in that public school that they were used to, they used to be in.
I guess logistically, if it's in a urban area with school districts
right
close, that can make sense. But that would be a conversation I'll have a little bit more detail in. But that'll answer my question for the time being. Senator Spell it all.
Yes, to inquire.
Proceed.
So I guess the first line of questioning, if you're a parent sending your kid to Sylvan Learning Center, will this tax credit benefit you?
First of all, in order to qualify, you have to be going to a public school to begin with.
Okay.
So you have to be, in the bill it's 100 days. I think it might make more sense to maybe do one semester. So if the committee deems that a good change, I think that might make more sense.
Okay.
But then they remove their child, you know, from public school because they seem that there might be a better way to meet their kids' education. And then if they're under the definition that we have here, then they could.
Okay. So they would have to go to public school first, and then they could utilize the credit.
Yeah.
Okay, that part I understand.
If we want to change that, I'm fine.
Some years ago, in the House, I guess it's the legislation I cut my teeth on in 2005 for the Betty L. Thompson Charity Scholarship Bill. And one of the reference points was the Arizona law that allowed for this type of spending or policy to occur. But one of the things that came up is that this public money was scholarship money was used for sporting equipment.
Yeah, I mean, we have a list. We have a definition on what it can be used for. I believe it's on page 8 of the bill.
I just wanted to make sure.
So it can be used for tuition fees. And if we need to tweak the definition, I'm open to tweaking it. But you have A, B, and C there, tuition and fees at a qualified school, textbooks required by the qualified school, educational therapies or services for the qualified student.
I personally don't want to see that happen because that's what
I agree.
In the original Arizona law. And I think so the other part of tutoring, you have, is it Title I that it should, I believe, go to tutoring students who are in public schools. Is there any kind of offset? Is there a possible offset if a school district does utilize some of their Title I funds and then in coordination with the parent who wants to get more tutor help? Can that work simultaneously with one student or not?
Well, we're talking about they wouldn't get the scholarship unless they actually were removed from the public school.
Mm-hmm.
So they're basically saying, I see a better way of doing this, there's better options out there, and I want that for my child.
Okay, so the one last thing is this. In St. Louis, we have a huge, huge problem. Many of our refugee kids don't do well in the public schools, and they're ostracized and they're teased, and it's just absolutely terrible. Would their parent, in your definition, would some of the immigrant and refugee children be able to utilize this?
I would believe so, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for the sponsor? Seeing none, how many wish to testify in favor of Senate Bill 313? Raise your hands.
3, 4, 5.
How many do we have to testify in opposition? Okay. All right, we will accommodate the in favor, and then we will go to the opposition on that completion. Do you have witnesses that you want to call in order, or just let them come forward?
I guess go ahead and come forward.
All right, if you wish to speak in favor of Senate Bill 313, please come forward. Fill a chair if there's one vacant here at the front table so that we can move along as quickly as possible. Be sure to have a witness form and leave it with us. And we'll start with this young lady here.
Thank you for letting me participate. Thank you, Senator, for preparing this legislation for your discussion and hopefully moving forward with it. I'm your former State of Missouri Veterans Ombudsman, Director of Operation Outreach. I have an MBA in healthcare admin and HR, and prior to being here at the state for over 20 years, I was a court reporter. My daughter, Lieutenant Kurt. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot. My name is Pat Rowe Kurter. Sorry. My daughter is Lieutenant. My daughter is Lieutenant Colonel Kate Numerick. She has three undergraduates from Vanderbilt, one master's from Vanderbilt, a master's from MU, and she's finishing her PhD from MU while in Germany. My 15-year-old grandson, in the last 6 years, has been in 7 schools because of the number of transfers she has had. 2 of those schools in Germany. So I'm here on behalf of the particular support of military families. We do have a lot of transition for our families. I personally have had the opportunity to work with well over 5,000. I'm also here as the grandma of a special needs child who is at a high level of on the autistic spectrum, and he is adorable. I mean, if he needs a Kleenex, it's a Kleenex for you, and then a Kleenex for him. And I'll tell you what, guys and gals, or your honors, we need to do all we can, whether it be for our children who are blind, our children who find themselves in our environments because their parents choose to serve to protect us, and I know some of you are our veterans, and we appreciate that greatly. And I would just ask that you look very closely at this and see what we could do to make a difference for all of our children, because without your support, they can't be the future that takes care of us in the long run. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Do we have questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Michaeline Kaiser. I live in Kansas City, Missouri, and my children attend school in the Liberty School District. I'm here today to testify in support of Senate Bill 313, as this legislation would greatly help my 16-year-old son, Dalton. At the age of 4, my son was diagnosed with autism, and shortly after receiving the news, we enrolled him at the Early Childhood Center in Liberty. Up until this year, I have been the sole advocate for Dalton at his IEP meetings. And while I've always had the highest regard for his classroom teachers, I have to say that sometimes administration has been a little more difficult to work with. On several occasions, I have been given incorrect information. And because of this, I took it upon myself to become more educated about the IEP process, and have since become engaged with groups such as IMPACT and the state's Partners in Policymaking program. At this point in Dalton's high school career, he's a sophomore this year at Liberty North High School, our family has felt it necessary to hire a professional advocate to help us rewrite Dalton's IEP and to hold the school accountable to fulfill his special need requirements. And hiring this advocate is for our family an out-of-pocket cost of about $3,000 to $4,000. I consider my family very fortunate that we're able to foot this bill at this time. However, I'm very well aware that this is not the case for many parents in our district and many parents in the state. I consider the services Dalton receives to be an integral component of his education, and they're going to help ensure his success after he completes high school. An ESA would allow me to build educational experience that I think would meet the unique needs of Dalton. Thank you this day for hearing my testimony. Thank you, Senator Koenig, for filing this legislation on behalf of children like my son, Dalton. Thank you.
Thank you very much for being here today. I have 2 grandkids attend the Liberty School District, and it's a good school district, but my one grandson was on IEP, and we had to fight as well to make sure that he received the proper education. So do appreciate and identify what you speak to that. Do we have a question for this witness? Senator Shipley.
Good afternoon. My first question is for the sponsor, and then I'd like to come back to you. So what would happen in this case? So they had to hire an advocate to rewrite the IEP under your legislation. Do they get support for doing that if they contribute to this?
The contributions or the funding mechanism is separate from the scholarships. So the people making the donations aren't necessarily the people that are receiving.
Okay.
You can't make a donation on behalf of a specific child.
All right, so would this family qualify for a donation to help rewrite the IEP?
No, not to rewrite it, no.
All right, so this family would have to move to another school district, is that correct? Or to another, or
well, they're in, if they're in a public school and the public school is not meeting their needs and they see other options that are better, then they could qualify for the scholarship program.
But they would need to leave the Liberty School
Correct.
District.
Okay. Correct.
So is that, would that be your intention under this legislation to have your grandson, Dalton, leave the Liberty School District?
He's my son.
I'm so sorry.
That's okay.
I did write that down correctly.
And at this point, Dalton is a sophomore. By the time we have his IEP rewritten, he will be almost into his junior year because it's about a 5-month process. For us as a family, we would probably not make the decision at this point in his education to leave the school district. But if this had been available to me earlier in Dalton's education, yes, that probably would have been a possibility.
So I'm just curious as to where you think that you might have preferred him to become educated.
There are some other schools in the city that are special needs schools. The money would have not probably covered the entire tuition, but would have helped towards the tuition. We may have done some homeschooling, but one of Dalton's struggles is reading comprehension, which is a lot of kids with autism. He could read every word on this page, blah, 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 but then he probably could not tell you what he read. I would have probably hired for him earlier a tutor outside of the district that would have helped him more with his reading comprehension. And this is something that we'll probably need out of pocket now for him because it's becoming a struggle for him as he gets older that I'm afraid when he gets a job, he won't be able to understand instructions given to him.
So, I'm sorry, I'm going to ask you to back up too. And you said if you had this available to you when he was younger, that there are some special education schools. Is that what I understood you to say?
Some private schools.
Some private schools
that are homeschooling with hiring some tutors to come in areas. Like I said, I probably don't know the best way to teach reading comprehension to somebody like him. I may have hired those people to come in and help.
All right. And I'm curious about this, what you're calling special education schools, because I really don't know what you mean by that. So do you have an example?
There's a school such as Horizon Academy.
Okay.
And that's on the Kansas side, but it is private. You can go from either school. And there's also a school called Astra, which deals with a lot of children on the autism spectrum.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Senator, would she have been able to utilize that money to take her child to Kansas?
Oh, Kansas? No, it had to be within the state of Missouri.
Okay. Thank you.
Senator Chevelle, no.
To inquire, I have a brief follow-up question. So some of these dollars would allow for children who are being homeschooled to utilize it, right, this service. But it would only be kids who, one, would have disabilities, or perhaps who are in families that are part of the military, because it wouldn't work for a foster kid, would it?
No, homeschooling wouldn't, but tuition at a school could. It could, you know, there could be a situation where the foster kid is already in a private school and then they get placed, and the idea is to keep them in the school that they're already in.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Any other questions for this witness? Thank you very much for your testimony.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Michael McShane. I'm Director of Education Policy for the Show Me Institute. It's a tough act to follow in talking about the needs of children, which I would have started with. But really, my testimony is on a very sort of technical issue, and I have written it up for you in the interest of time, and will submit it as written testimony. I released a real page-turner of a study this summer with the title Estimating the Fiscal Impact of a Tax Credit Scholarship Program. And it wasn't this program particularly. We talk about tax credit scholarships and tax credit-funded ESAs in general, and walk through how to calculate what the fiscal impact of that might be. And we showed all of our math so that you could plug in what Senator Koenig's bill does to try and get some understanding of how it might affect the state budget as well as local district budgets.
Thank you, Senator Chappelle.
Okay, I don't know who this is geared towards, but any of you can answer it. Again, this sounds very simple, especially with your testimony. Sounds very, very similar to the bills that were introduced in 2005 and 2006. And since it is so similar to that, I guess one of the concerns I have is the participation of the third-party entity, the administrative body that takes in the tax credit. Because I did an entire diagram for this in 2005 and 2006. So, you know, the administrative costs was a concern that came up in 2005.
Yeah, we have limits in the bill.
Okay, and what's that limit?
It starts out at 90% have to go for scholarships, but then depending on how much money they take in, it goes down from there.
Okay, so there is a cap on administrative costs.
Correct.
That is good. Another concern, I guess.
And the department does get to keep 2%.
Why? That's different. Yeah. That's different.
Well, it's what we have in there. It's what we do with taxes. But I'm open to change.
So, but it would be our money anyway because this
right.
is a tax liability.
Right.
So we would be holding on what's in general revenue anyway.
Right.
So it would not be like really just, okay. All right. There are probably more questions that I have on this, but this bill is reminding me of 2005 and 2006.
Senator Emery.
Thanks, Chairman. But Michael, could you just, were there conclusions of your study that you could just very briefly give us?
The very brief conclusion, and it kind of, it goes against the current, I've seen the fiscal note for this bill that I would argue sort of gets half of it right, in the sense that there are costs associated with this bill. Obviously, if you give $50 million in tax credits out, there's 50 fewer million dollars in the coffers. But the thing to take into account that the fiscal note notes but doesn't quantify is that for every child that takes advantage of this bill, that is one fewer student that the state pays to educate. So you basically sort of, you start, if you would imagine, in a $50 million hole, and with each student, it digs out of that. So that's roughly the math that's in there. There's a sort of calculation that's made at the district level as well, but that's the 30,000 foot look at it.
You know,
I'm sorry.
Senator Chappelle.
In part, that's misleading, though, because every single district is different, whether or not you are hold harmless or you're a formula district. If you, in some districts, it is as much as 57% that comes from the state. So the state is still spending that money. And for the school district, if you are paying 75%, then that would be a difference. I mean, that would be a difference for that school district, but you still, if you're a advocate for the school district, you still have the same overhead costs. Those
sure.
remain the same.
Yes, so that's correct. What we try to do in the second half of the paper is use, I teamed up with an economist on this to look at some of the fixed versus variable costs. So costs that can shift as enrollment shrinks and grows, and those that are fixed, so things like capital expenses and others. So we try to take all that into account. We also try to adjust as much as possible for the funding formula, the weighted average daily attendance, the dollar cost multiplier, and all those pieces that are in there.
Okay, so Senator, you may want to have a triggering effect in here where if this scholarship ends up to the point so many students are leaving that school district or that school district has to shut a building down, that district is protected and doesn't have all that extra overhead cost that they would normally have if, let me see if I'm phrasing this correctly. Do you understand what I'm talking about? If you get to a point where school district A has so many students who are taking advantage of this program that it ends up shutting down a school or a facility in that public school district, that public school district should not have to pay for that. And so there should be some kind of triggering something in there that says if we ever, I don't think we'd ever get to that.
I don't see that happening. I mean, the $50 million is essentially $50 million less that, is going to be in our general revenue. But, it doesn't necessarily, it's going to be part of the formula. So, we spend billions on education.
Yeah, it's a third of our entire expenditure.
Yeah, if you include higher education and K-12, it's over 50% of our budget, which is probably, I don't know the exact number, maybe $4.5 billion. And then if you include the local money, that's you know, another 4 or 5 billion, probably. I don't know where what the number is, but you're talking 50 million out of potentially $10 billion. I mean, it is a slither.
Okay, so the other question is this third party entity, the administrative body of this entire thing, are they the ones who are determining which kid gets to go to what school?
No, the parents would decide.
Okay,
that.
The parents decide that.
Because the parents may decide that they kind of want to do a homeschooling, use tutoring by curriculum, and in that case, they might not spend all $6,000 or up to the state adequacy target, be substantially below that amount. Or they may, maybe they want to go part-time at a school, or maybe they want to use it all for tuition. So it allows the parents to really give the parent flexibility on to meet the needs of their child.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you very much. If you guys will make a close to it, we have a couple other folks that will be seated. And be sure to leave witness forms for us today.
Okay. Sherry Hobbs is a Missouri Education Reform Counselor. And as many of you are aware, I was a school administrator for 24 years. So I'm going to speak toward that in my testimony. As many of you know, most of the schools in our state, public schools in our state, do a good job educating the majority of our students. We also know that over 80% of the families will always choose to send their child to the local neighborhood public school. However, even the best schools in our state are not meeting the needs of every student who is enrolled in their school. As found on the DESE website, 37%, or nearly 330,000 students, in our public schools are not proficient in English language arts. 51%, or nearly 453,000 students, are not proficient in math. In addition, 11,000 of the students in public schools drop out and do not graduate. This is nearly 90,000 students who are dropping out annually. It is evident that one size fits all, and our approach to educating students in our public schools is not working. Some children need a different school or curriculum than what neighborhood public schools offer, so the ESA program can be a lifeline for these students. It's also important to note that the establishment of ESAs is not an attempt to undermine nor destroy public education in any way. Public education for our students is needed. The main purpose of an ESA is to provide parents with an opportunity to develop a customized plan that best meets unique needs of their children. For example, in addition to providing tuition as an option, a parent may use ESA funding to customize an education plan to employ a private tutor, as we mentioned before, online learning, AP courses. It's also important to note that Missouri special education law does not require public schools to provide a Cadillac plan. So when parents come in and they demand, that they want this service, that service, and whatever else, that schools do not provide that unless it's what they call educationally relevant. An ESA can help parents with these special needs that are attending a public school then gain access to additional services beyond what the school is providing. We can compare an ESA concept to the apps on your phone. If one app was able to meet the needs of all of our needs, then we would only have one app on our phone. If you're like me, you probably have many apps on your phone. And also, you probably would have many different apps because you have different needs. So the ESA is simply another way to allow parents to customize an education plan that best meets their unique needs for their children. And if legislators pass this tax credit ESA bill and the governor signs into law, the use of this tax credit money will be for the sole purpose of helping parents meet the unique needs of their children in our state and not enrich the pockets of a few.
As I was trying to listen to your testimony, it seems like you were speaking more in general as an ESA for all students as opposed to special needs. It seemed to the essence of your testimony was focused on education savings accounts as a whole.
Well, I'm in favor of that, but I'm also in support of
right, that's all I think of that. Any other questions for this witness? Seeing them, thank you for your testimony.
My name is Erin Koch, and I have today with me my husband and my kids, Riley and Sam, who we homeschool. We also have with us our foster baby here today. He is 2 months old, and as you can see, he's a dog. He is our 21st foster child to come stay with us. Some kids stayed for just a few days, others for several months. Some have come to our home with a neatly packed suitcase, others with a lice-infested trash bag full of damp clothing, or a single outfit paid for from their social worker. I want to talk to you today about what it would mean to these kids to have the opportunity to stay in their own school. As you know, when a foster child is placed with a foster family, that child moves to their school district. So not only do they no longer see their family, their home, their stuff, they also don't see their classroom, their friends, their playground, or their teachers. We know that children from happy homes go to school to learn, but children from unhealthy homes go to school to be loved. And they are loved well at school. Missouri public schools are filled with amazing teachers who somehow manage to not only teach our children, but also to love them. I'm sure you could ask any teacher in the room and they could easily name off for you the kids in their classrooms who need new shoes, who come to school hungry most days, and who they pray for the most. For many kids who enter the system, they miss their teachers as much as they miss their parents, because for many of them, their teachers have been their very best advocates and their sole source of stability. I am blessed to live in Atlanta School District. The principals and teachers have been amazing to try to fold in our foster kids into their classrooms. They have diligently worked with their special needs, transferred IEPs, learned their triggers, and also what was best to settle them. Honestly, it's a lengthy process that adds tremendously to the teacher's workload. And in the same way that no matter how great of a foster mom I am, they still want their real mom. No matter how good the teacher is, they still want their real teacher. With the passing of this legislation, we could make that happen. When a child is placed with a new foster family, they could go to their school and that part of their life could remain blissfully unchanged. For that 7 hours, they wouldn't have to worry about when they see their parents again, or try to learn the rules of a new school, or try to come up with a story to tell their new classmates that makes moving in with strangers sound normal. They can simply be themselves. And they can connect with the teacher who has already spent the school year loving them. They can feel safe knowing that at a time in their life when nothing seems stable, school still is. Our farm sits on the junction of three school districts. Our neighbors go to Macon, our other neighbors go to South Shelby. If my neighbor's son happened to be placed in my home as a foster child, he would have to move school districts. This to me seems like an undue hardship for a child who would already be going through so much, when this legislation could change how things are done and help to improve the continuity of care for these kids. In Missouri, we have over 13,000 children in the foster care system. They will average 24 months in care, and the average age is 10, just 1 year younger than my boy. That means that we literally have thousands of school-aged children who will necessarily be removed from their homes to ensure their safety. I would ask that you would prayerfully consider the impact of this legislation and what a difference it can make to these children to not also be removed from their schools. Thank you.
Thank you very much for you and your family being here today. Do we have any questions for this witness? Senator Emery.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. And I'm sorry, I missed your name.
Aaron Koch.
Aaron. So we just in a guesstimate of the foster, how many foster children have you had?
We've had 21.
Of that 21, how many of those do you think would have benefited from Senator Koenig's scholarship?
We've just had four who've been school age, and all of them would have benefited. They were all in situations where they had special needs, they had structure in the school that they were in, the new school had to learn everything all over again. And it would have benefited all of them. And they loved where they were. It's hard to be removed from your home and to be removed from everything you know on top of that. It's just an extreme difficulty for these guys.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions for this witness? Tina, thank you very much. Kate?
Well, I can't really follow that. So, Kate Casas, Excellence in Education in Action, and just wanted to go on record in support of the bill. I would be happy to answer any questions now, or you guys see me all the time, so if any time is to not take up time.
All right. Well, thank you very much for that testimony. Do we have any questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, my name is Frank Flotron. I represent K-12 Incorporated. You had an opportunity last week to learn an awful lot about virtual education. They provide virtual education in almost 35 states, and there's one group of folks that really greatly benefit from them, and those are the children of folks in the military that get transferred all over the country and all over the world, and virtual education is an opportunity for those kids to have continuity with teachers and a regular program. That's all I have to say, unless you have any questions.
Thank you very much. Any questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Pull the microphone up, please. Introduce yourself and be sure to leave us a witness form, and the floor is yours.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee.
You can pull the mic close.
All right, thank you. My name is Sharon Ferris, and this is my daughter, Lily. Lily is in the kindergarten at Eunice Thomas Elementary in Pasco, Missouri, about a 4.5-hour drive from here. Previously, we had moved from Cassville to Kansas City so she could attend Kansas School for the Blind. We are here today to encourage you to pass this legislation in Missouri so families like ours have options. Currently, our local public school has the staffing facilities that meet Lily's needs. She is blind and suffers from seizures, and she is currently training with an aid dog to help her with both. As Lily's health and her needs change, we believe her current school will be able to continue to meet her needs. However, we don't know what is ahead for Lily, and we don't know what the personnel and other changes are ahead for our school. For this reason, we would like the option for applying for a scholarship if needed, to find other alternatives for Lily, such as an aid worker that can come to our home and teach her Braille, virtual school resources, and return to a more specialized school. Any of these options will actually be less expensive than the current education program required by our local K-12 school. The Missouri Board Association has done good work, and I'm here to tell you that currently our school is meeting Lily's needs, but with budget constraints and personnel changes ahead, if we are all really concerned with Lily's education, we should allow the scholarship program to be established so families like ours have options. Thank you.
Thank you, Lily, for being here today. Do we have any questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you very much. Appreciate you being here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members of the committee, Ryan Stauffer, Missouri Chamber of Commerce. We also want to go on record in support of the bill as well. Obviously, each individual child has their own unique skills and talents, especially the ones that qualify under this bill. Anything we can do to empower parents to choose the education that best allows them to foster those skills and talents going into the workforce we're in support of. Be happy to take any questions.
Any questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Alex Eaton representing Missouri Century Foundation, and want to go on record in support of Senate Bill 313. We feel this provides great flexibility for parents and students.
Any questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to testify in favor of Senate Bill 313? Seeing none, anyone wishing to speak in opposition to Senate Bill 313, please come forward. We have three seats available. If there's more than one, please make your way up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members of the committee, Mike Wood representing the Missouri State Teachers Association. Couple of concerns. One is a $50 million tax credit when we're struggling to fund our schools, especially transportation in the current budget situation we find ourselves in. But I don't want to talk too much about money. The biggest issue I think maybe that you might want to consider on this bill is the lack of accountability. The lack of accountability for the tax credit itself and the lack of accountability for scholarship recipients. I think we want to make sure that any recipient of any type of scholarship is accountable for that, and that it is going to a quality education program. So I think at some point in time we need to add accountability measures to this bill, both on the tax credit side and on the student side as well.
Do you see an opportunity that school districts can contract in some way or set up a system in which that if they have the oversight management of this, that something is workable?
I don't know that the sponsors of this would want the school districts to be the ones, or the school districts would want to be the ones that would be accountable for the recipients, but I think there would be, basically to answer your question, I think there's a way that we can come up with some accountability measures to ensure that recipients are progressing the way they should under these. And it's going to be very difficult because now we're dealing with students with some with severe disabilities in there, but I think we've still got to make sure that those students are accountable as they currently are.
And the reason why I ask is, as I mentioned earlier, my granddaughter is special needs. She goes to the state school.
Yeah.
She's on the bus for an hour, and someone in her condition, it breaks my heart. I hate to see that. I wish there was other options closer to home. We have a great facility in the Hillsboro area, or Ponyburg, which does a great job that if we get a facility built in our area, we'd like to work with. So, I, you know, the concept makes sense, but I strongly believe that you have to have a central figure, which is the local school district that has oversight. And so if there's a way to manage the two, I would sure like to have that conversation. And if you think there's a way, I would like to encourage that conversation.
Very much so. Thank you, Senator.
Any questions for this witness? Senator Emmer.
Thanks, Chairman. Mike, you've read the bill. I'm sure you've read the criteria for qualifying a student. You've read the list of things that the money can be spent for. And of course, we're trusting the parent. I mean, we're saying the parents are the ones accountable for their children's education. So can you point specifically to the things that where you think the abuse will happen in that list of allowable expenses?
Oh, I don't, my testimony was not on abuse of allowable expenses. My testimony was, I think, that if a student is receiving a scholarship, that there should be some accountability that they're receiving a quality education under that scholarship.
So you think the parents would not pay attention to that?
Well, I think the parents have their best, I mean, the best will of their children at heart, but you could go to a program, you could be enrolled in a program that's not in the best interest of your child, or that's not meeting the needs of your child.
Right now, the parents think they're in a program that's not meeting the needs of the child, right? So we're trying to allow them to have an option. So you're saying, I mean, so what should they do about where they are now if under your accountability?
Well, I think that school needs to be accountable for those students that are in there to show that they're making the progress.
So what do you think we should do there? I mean, how do we do that?
Boy, with students with disabilities, I'm going to have to turn the experts on that one to see. But obviously, we have IEPs now, and we try to meet the goals of the IEPs, and I think that's something that could be lost here. The current IEP has goals in it that it gets evaluated on a periodic basis.
Right.
And I think for these kids, there needs to be some type of program in place for these kids to make sure that the goals are being met or they're making progress toward those goals.
I just find it frustrating that every time there is a choice offered to parents, the standard opposition is lack of accountability. We want these to look just like the public schools do, which is what parents are trying to say we think is a better option.
I think I answered Senator Romine's question is that I didn't necessarily want the public school to be the ones to do that. I'm not saying it needs to look like just like it. I just think there needs to be some sort of accountability member, both accountability measures on there, some sort. I'm not saying it has to be the public school to look just like the public school, but there needs to be some accountability in there to ensure that they're getting quality.
And we're talking about parental accountability.
I understand. But we're also talking about a scholarship program that's backed up with tax dollars, and I think there needs to be some accountability for that.
Right, which is exactly the dollars that are being spent now.
But do we want accountability for tax dollars, or do we not want accountability for tax dollars?
Tax dollars, that distinction, but I understand. Well, I understand exactly
right.
What you're saying. Okay,
right.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Spellendahl.
To inquire. I should have brought my dog at this point, because this is when I'm blowing my top. So we've been sitting, I'm between a rock and a hard place right now, because for bills like this in the past, I've killed them. And when you say things such as, we need to look out for money, accountability, quality, and I'm thinking about all of those children who are still in unaccredited school buildings, and you were up here talking about, we're going to do fine enough in our public schools, we have the answer. I'm talking about the transfer bill.
Oh, okay.
I'm talking about the transfer bill. We've been trying to save children, not for a decade, but for two decades in some circumstances. And that's accountability, that's public school accountability, which has failed. It's failed. You know, and so that's why at this moment, you know, I'm in a quandary because I'm trying to figure out, okay, how can we clean up 313? But I sure as heck don't want to go back to what you call accountability in public school districts that look like mine, unaccredited, because that's not accountability at all. Where generations of children are being failed, and you come in this room, or other organizations come in this room and say, oh, the public school districts are just doing fine. And we have kids who are graduating, if they graduate, with a third grade reading level. So I'm trying to understand, like, where I'm going to be in this bill, because on one hand, I get what you're saying, because I've been there, done that over a decade ago. On the other hand, we still have no resolution for children who are terribly, they're in a situation where they are not going to be able to have the same resources as other students throughout this state.
And I don't
know. Do you understand?
No, I understand exactly where you're at, because we find ourselves in the same boat.
How long is it going to happen?
But I don't know that, and I don't want to rehash the whole transfer situation, is our opposition to those bills was not to allow transfer and not allow those kind of abilities. There was other things that were added to the bill, I think, that eventually got us to oppose those bills. But when they first started, we weren't necessarily in opposition to them, because we agree with you. Students should not be in any failing school district, whether it be a charter school, whether it should be a public school, whether it should be a private school. We want what's best for kids that are out there. So without rehashing the whole charter thing, Senator, I think I agree with you. And I see the quandary you're in. My testimony on this particular bill is that it doesn't have to look like a public school accountability, but I think there needs to be some measure of accountability to ensure that the scholarship is going to a quality program.
And I understand students who have a really hard time, and parents who are looking after their children and just hoping and praying that they get the best resources possible. But I think when you get to a point like this, and I can only use my own experience, when you get to a point where your own public school district has failed your child, your parent, if it's a parent who is just on it, like many parents are just on it, they find whatever possible that's available to help their child succeed. And if that district, kids only have a certain amount of time. 12 years is a really short amount of time to learn all the key things that you need to learn. And as we've just been debating year after year just in this, I mean, my goodness, fifth grade, middle school, high school, for a lot of our kids, we lose our kids in middle school.
Well, I taught elementary school for 10 years. Mm-hmm. It was the same thing. There was probably, in my 10-year career, there was kids I'd rather take, I mean, that I just loved and wanted to take home because I wanted to give them an opportunity. I mean, I'm not a parent.
I'm going to remember what you said right now.
Senator, I think we agree more than we disagree on some of this.
For the rest of this session, I'm going to remember that.
Okay.
Just let me know.
You betcha.
Any other questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you very much. Who's next?
Okay.
Sorry. Otto Page, on behalf of Missouri NEA, we're also mindful that there's another bill to be heard, but this bill, Senate Bill 313, presents things that are of concern to us. There's almost like there's the concerns that are legion, that pertain to the tax credit method of doing this, that are in the way of the discussion that probably needs to be had about some solutions to these issues, along with a broader challenge. You know, I'm not here to say that everything that is going on in the way that the state is implementing public education is the way we wish it to be. We are pretty outspoken in our desire to see some significant changes to allow schools, districts, and staff to innovate. And so that's where we hear frustrations about where the public school isn't meeting a parent's needs. Our concern often is this is the effect of things that come from above that make it harder for us to deal directly with each kid in what they need that particular day, whether it's federal law that just got changed a year ago that really pushed states in a particular direction, whether it is state board accreditation and policies that continue in that mindset and make it hard. If we want to think about things like really focusing on proficiency, where we make sure that educational success is something that becomes the norm for every kid, and we take them exactly and move them forward exactly as we see fit each day so that they're always making success, so we don't have these arbitrary questions about retention and grade level versus success day after day after day. It's hard for our schools to think about that when they are constrained as they are. You could right now, you will know less about what you've done with regard to foster students by passing this bill because of the tax credit nature. There's nothing here that speaks to a particular student or parent being selected. But if you all were to pass legislation changing the state's enrollment policy about foster students, you could change that just like that. And our association has supported that for many years, along with many of the worthwhile changes you've already done with regard to foster education. You could change it just like that and make sure that there could be continuity of attendance for foster students. And you would know that for every child, because you're not relying on a tax credit, you have changed the enrollment policy of the state. So that's an opportunity that you have right now where you'll have surety. This bill does not give you surety. We don't know which students would be selected to receive scholarships. And particularly as it relates to students with disabilities,
The bill seems to purport that they could essentially surrender their rights to education while they're enrolled in some other place. The Constitution doesn't really provide a framework for that. Every student has that right. And so it purports to do that. Federal law probably doesn't allow the school district to be excused from its obligation, but it seems to attempt to do that. Finally, we have to mention this concern that we have, and that is the idea of having lookbacks in a provision that relates to public school values. This bill says that you wouldn't be able to participate in something that's going to be publicly funded and putatively operate like a public school program based upon whether you were or were not enrolled in a public school in a prior year. We have a concern about anything that doesn't treat the students and their parents based upon the circumstances of the current time.
Thank you. Any questions for this witness? Senator.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. So Otto, you're, in regards to what we can do right now, you're saying with the foster children,
yeah,
you just simply excuse them from...
You can craft the special provision that deals with their enrollment that could allow, you know, whatever degree of enrollment continuity you wish to try to accomplish. The example that was given was where there was a region that was affected by boundaries. We think that the
UNEA has supported that in the past.
We have.
Okay.
And we support a number of, and you all have done many things within the last decade to improve the status of foster students, but we have a long way to go.
I have not been involved in trying to do that, so I don't know exactly what's involved. That's a great idea. I think what that does is it means that if Senator Koenig's language passes, that would broaden the number of people that we could reach, because we don't have to provide scholarships for that group. They could just simply stay in the school where they were.
Correct.
The existing structure, okay.
And you would have certainty rather than the uncertainty that you get from anything that's mediated by a third party bureaucracy.
No, I think that's a good point. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions for this witness? Seeing none.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Scott Kimball on behalf of the School Administrators Coalition. We too would like to go on record in opposition to Senate Bill 313 for the following reasons. First, it has been asserted that Senate Bill 313 will provide choice for students with disabilities. It's our contention that this bill isn't really for students with special needs. That can be seen given the fact that there is no provision in the bill that would require private schools accepting these dollars to adhere to IDEA. As such, there is no requirement to provide specialized instruction to special needs students or to hire individuals that have certification in special education. Further, this bill strips disabled students of their rights under IDEA, the only act specifically designed to provide protections for special needs students. Moreover, on page 8, lines 5 through 7, it states that a qualified student shall enroll in a qualified school and receive an education in at least the subjects of reading, grammar, mathematics, social studies, and science. For the severely disabled, this provision would likely prevent them from taking advantage of this choice. Also, under the definition of qualified student, it states that a qualified student is a student identified as having a disability under Section 504 or a child eligible to receive services under IDEA, not that a student is being served under a 504 plan or is receiving services under IDEA. This bill is much broader in scope as a result of this language. It's seeking to expand to students that aren't necessarily in need of accommodations or services, but merely have a label. Second, in keeping in that same vein, the bill is much broader than just pertaining to students with disabilities, foster care kids, and children who have a parent in active military services. Actually, the bill pertains to all kids who have attended a public school as a full-time student for at least the first 100 days of the prior school year, and to any child who is eligible to begin kindergarten. So you don't have to be a disabled student, a student in foster care, or a student whose parents are active military. Third, the bill permits private schools to implement a self-designed selection process to decide who they will choose to educate. Thus, these entities would be free to pick and choose who they admit based potentially on severity of disability, thus allowing private schools to discriminate on the basis of severity of disability. The Council of Parent Attorneys and Advocates, COPA, noted as much in June of 2016 in a review of school voucher programs. COPA's findings illustrate that special education specific voucher programs typically fail to include all students with disabilities, and it is rare for programs to accept students who are significantly disabled. Fourth, keeping in that same vein, the bill permits private schools to discriminate against students on the basis of disability, religion, and gender, as the schools would not be required to alter their creed, practices, admissions, policies, or curriculum. And given that the bill actually states that a qualified school would only be prevented from discriminating on the basis of race, color, and national origin. Fifth, the bill is a $50 million tax credit. Over a 10-year period, it will divert at a minimum $500 million from general revenue, which would have been used to fund things like the foundation formula, public safety, or higher education. As you know, the legislature has not fully funded the foundation formula, and the ability to attain that full funding figure looks bleak with the announcement of the governor's proposed budget. On top of that, we are currently underfunding the state-mandated transportation allotment of reimbursing school districts for 75% of their allowable costs.
We have questions for this one, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Can I ask a question to the sponsor?
Sure.
So, Senator, is this brand new language, or has this language been used in any other state? Do you know if this is modeled after anything?
Well, I mean, it's an ESA that we modeled after other states. But the specific language could vary from state to state.
Sure. But this language or some structure of it has been working in a number
correct,
of states.
Correct.
So why is it not the disaster that this witness is claiming it's going to be?
Because I just think they want everybody in a government school, no matter what the case. And the notion that it applies to every child is not my intention. Reading the bill on page 7, it says, these are the criteria for following. If you meet that criteria, then you also have to do any of the following. And if one of those criteria was being in a public school for 100 days, or anybody entering kindergarten.
Yeah, I guess the main thing is that we're not pioneering here. This is not a new idea. There are a number of states that are doing things like this.
And there is criteria on the different services that are provided. I just lost my place and where that was.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions from this witness? Seeing none, thank you. Sir?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name's Larry Feld. I'm a member of the Melville School Board in South St. Louis County. And I'm speaking today as the president of the Missouri School Boards Association. And I'm speaking for 400 school districts and approximately 3,000 elected school board members. It's kind of a pleasure to get to talk to elected officials once in a while. My concern with this bill, and this is, I'm going to talk from a school board perspective. I'm the one that's got to balance the budget, make sure that all the IDE requirements are met, make sure transportation is met. One of the things that struck me when I read this bill is I expected to see something about special education. I expected to see something about what is it we're not doing in the public school system that we need other help. And I would tell you that if I were sitting on top of a fully funded school system and someone came to me and said, special education's not meeting the need, we'd be the first one in line to help you. But this is not a very simple, straightforward process. There's issues of diverting $50 million worth of revenue. Well, that's now we're going to have to compete in general fund more for anything, whether it's from public school funding to infrastructure to anything of that nature that, social services. So my great concern with all of this is we're making the current funding structure much more difficult with this. The other thing we look at from an MSB perspective is process improvement. We need to understand how things work so we can make them better. Most of the discussion I've heard in this room talks about special education as a process, as a craft, as a need for students. I don't see anything in here that deals with that, that makes it better in this state. I don't see anything that improves the overall process. We don't claim to be perfect, but we take everybody that comes in and we make sure we can do everything we can with them. Just a couple of side notes. 3 pages of typing and I can't use it all. One of the things that struck me in here were some of the things that you could be compensated for, like mileage and certain testing. And transportation, that was the one that got me. Because we're supposed to be funded at 75% for route-related things. We'll be at 13% on the next distribution. So again, it gets back to my point. Are we going to continue to give money away from the revenue, or are we going to make decisions on the priorities that we already have?
Thank you, sir. Any questions for this witness? Senator Shute.
I actually have a question for the sponsor. My understanding from this bill is that transportation for the students who qualify will be funded at 100%. versus the 13 to 18 that we're talking about for public school students.
What do you mean 100%? It's 100% of IRS allowable. That's spelled out very well in the bill.
Right.
My point is that what we currently have is 75, I believe, was this statute. It was like 1991 or something like that. The last time it was at that level, I think. I could be wrong on that. I could be thinking 20. But it's really an issue of, for expenses we get about 13% back of what we get. Under this bill, someone who incurs travel restrictions would get 100% of the IRS allowable.
Right, and I want to comment, and I'm glad that you brought it to our attention. So I served on a school board from 2000 to 2006. And since that time, so 17 years ago, that foundation formula has never been fully funded. And, we would like to be everything to everyone, and I think the public schools really try to do that, but it's almost impossible. And if we were fully funded, maybe we would be able to provide some additional services that we aren't. But I think that the growth of special school district in St. Louis County is one example of an area where we're trying to find ways to support kids, especially those with special needs. So, we take everyone, as you said. I think that those are really important points to make. This bill doesn't require anybody on the receiving end to necessarily take these kids, but the public schools are always there. They're the backup, they're the safety net for everyone. And I think based on those things, public schools do a heck of a good job. So I appreciate the testimony.
Any other questions for this witness? Seeing none, thank you, sir. Thank you. Anyone else wishing to testify in opposition to Senate Bill 313? Seeing none, anyone wishing to testify for informational purposes only? Seeing none, Senator, any closing remarks?
Yeah, one quick thing. I know you have another bill. On page 8 at the bottom, there is criteria on what the money can be spent for instance, tutoring services provided by a tutor that's accredited by the state or national accrediting organization. For educational therapies, they have to be a licensed or accredited practitioner. So there are requirements in there that there's some criteria for quality.
Thank you, Senator. That will conclude the hearing.